Today, we continue our journey through every animated feature film created by Walt Disney Studios.
Previously, we explored the film that started it all, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs.
It currently rests as number one on the Matterhorn Movies list of great Disney films.
This week, we will explore the next feature in the lineup, 1940's Pinocchio.
I'm Matterhorn Matt.
And I'm Jeremy.
And we invite you to come with us on our journey through animation.
Star makes no difference who you are. Anything your heart desires will come to you. If your heart is in your dream, no request.
Okay, so now we're going to talk about our personal history with the film, our personal background. So I first saw Pinocchio, same with Snow White last time. I probably don't have a first memory of seeing this film. It's just kind of a film you grow up and watch at a very young age, and you watch it over and over again, and you don't really have the first memory. But I do remember watching it when I was a kid, I'm sure I loved it. A scene that left a vital impression on me. I don't know why, but I vividly remember being a kid watching the clock sequence at the beginning, and I remember loving all the different clocks that it showed. So that's something I vividly remember, responding to as a kid. I liked it probably because, you know, it's a film that actually is about a kid. And I think all kids can relate to when they see themselves on the screen in an honest way. But how about you, Matt? What's your personal history with Pinocchio?
Well, same as Mr. Jeremy here. I watched this film when I was very little. I do have memories of seeing and watching the VHS tape in my grandma's house. You know, same as we said with Snow White. I remember watching it as a kid. Sure, I'm sure I loved it. I don't have the best memory when it comes to all those years ago. It makes me sound like I'm 80 years old. I'm not, but that's just how it feels to me. But yeah, saw it when I was a kid. I'm sure I loved it. Coming back watching it, as an adult, I really love it. And yeah. Well, Jeremy and I have prepared some statements that we would like to read to you guys about the film, and I guess I'll start. Pinocchio is a big step up from the quote-unquote trial run of Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, with improvements in nearly every aspect of the film, from the story to the characters to the score, the music, and of course the animation. It almost feels to me like Pinocchio is an overlooked film in a lot of Disney film watchers' movie catalog, but for me, Pinocchio is a classic film that teaches kids right from wrong through Pinocchio's almost childlike point of view.
And now I'll read my prepared statement for all you wonderful people. A lot of myths seem to surround Walt Disney and his studio, but none seem to be so unquestioned as truth than the idea that Walt's famous animated films were nothing short of unsophisticated fluff. When rewatching his 1940 feature Pinocchio, I couldn't help but to begin to question this universally accepted point of view. What I watched was quite possibly, so far, the most philosophically complex, visually stunning, and emotionally riveting piece of film in all of the Walt Disney Studios' 80-plus year history. In this viewing, all of those assumptions we've made over the decades about what an animated film is, particularly a Disney one, went completely out the window. Rather, I saw a film about childhood, the manipulation of innocence, parenthood, and communication. Pinocchio is an all-in-all morality tale that questions what morality even means and who defines it. By the film's climax, our protagonists are forced to challenge what they think morality means within themselves. Unfortunately, its philosophical richness is probably what cost it audiences when it first was released. Don't get me wrong, this film is sublimely entertaining, but it also teeters on the edge of the absurd, once again proving the experimental instincts of the early Disney artists. The animation itself is a major improvement from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs just 3 years prior. The range of life shown in all the characters proves Disney's superiority in advancing the art of animation over all other studios at the time. Technology aside, it is purely the leadership of Walt and the creative genius of his artists that set the standard for the form. An artist himself, Geppetto exclaims after his latest creation, "He almost looks alive." I'm sure Walt and his artists felt similarly as they were working on their latest film. Animators bringing humanity to the screen with their pencil sketches is not too dissimilar from Geppetto creating a puppet to keep him company. I recommend Pinocchio to everyone, not just because it is a classic in the Disney canon, but because it is a fundamental step in the evolution of animation, or as the animators themselves would call it, the illusion of life.
All right, well, once again, Jeremy's way with words have stolen the show. Well.
It's all downhill from here.
Oh my God. Of course.
Now we're going to move on to our series of favorites. We're going to begin with favorite character. For me, it's Jiminy Cricket.
You copycat.
It's okay. We can have the same one. I love Jiminy Cricket, and I have a few theories as to why he is probably not just my favorite character, but Matt's favorite character, and probably, if you're really paying attention, everyone's favorite character. Mm. Jiminy Cricket is, first of all, we follow the film from the perspective of Jiminy Cricket, so we're already kind of with him. We're in on his thought process. We're in on him. He's in on us, too. He knows we're there watching, and he can turn to us and offer us some side comments. He is the audience's perspective. He offers contemporary commentary in a cynical and ironic way, and he uses even modern slang, like what's up. And even Jiminy Cricket itself is a modern slang phrase. So already we feel in on it because we have a way in from our contemporary sensibilities. And that makes it interesting because Jiminy Cricket offers then what would be the modern moral sensibilities onto Pinocchio. And of course, we see how that pans out. So it's really interesting. It's kind of like the audience is able to project their sense of morality onto Jiminy Cricket, who then, you know, throws it onto Pinocchio and the other characters and creates the kind of mess that's going on of what is morality. So of course everyone loves that character because he's us. He's our comments. He's our modern sensibilities. And he's great. He's funny, he's lovable, and Ward Kimball's animation of him, which we'll probably talk about later, is just perfect. Now, how about you, Matt? Why do you love Jiminy Cricket so much?
Well, trying not to echo everything Jeremy just said, because I do have Jiminy Cricket as my number one favorite character. I went ahead and had, like, honorable mentions for a lot of these categories,
right, yeah.
Just because Jiminy Cricket, my number one of the funniest characters in these classic Disney films. He adds a bit of adult humor to the movie, as Jeremy mentioned as well. He's really funny. I'm a big fan. My runner-up is Geppetto. The love that he has, not just for Pinocchio,
of course,
but for Cleo, Figaro, and for all the children that he makes, the toys, warms my heart. And even the Blue Fairy has that comment where she says, you give so much happiness to others, you deserve to have your wish come true. Love Geppetto. He reminds me of my grandpa a lot. I feel like that can relate to a lot of people. But yeah, Geppetto's my second favorite. Final. Last but not least, Figaro, you guys. I have a soft spot for cats. And Figaro is such
great.
A cutie pie, you guys. When Geppetto makes him kiss Cleo goodnight, oof, so cute.
Absolutely, yeah. Geppetto, definitely a runner-up for me. We'll talk a little bit about the character building in this movie, I'm sure, but I mean, you fall in love with the guy right away, and, you know, it's like, absolutely wonderful. You really feel for him, and when he gets his wish by the end of the film, it's not really Pinocchio you feel happy for, it's Geppetto.
Yeah.
You know? And, absolutely wonderful, and it's all around. I mean, it's the character animation, it's the writing, it's the voice acting, it's everything about that character that makes him so wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Moving on, favorite scenes from the movie. One of my absolute favorite scenes, and I do have a couple runner-ups here that I'd like to talk about, but one of my absolute favorites is the ending scene where Pinocchio and the whole fam try to escape Monstro. I remember it being so tense as a kid when Monstro first sneezes them out of his mouth and then he sucks them back in as he's, you know, breathing in, about to sneeze again, and, you know, he blows them out again. Really tense. It holds up a lot, I feel like, at least in my opinion, all these years later from seeing it as a kid. It shows how determined Pinocchio is to save his family, because at that point he's grown as a character a lot compared to the beginning of the film. And of course, in the end, when he sacrifices himself to save Geppetto, which is that key moment for him that eventually gets him turned into the real boy. I do have a runner-up, though. When Lampwick gets turned into a donkey.
Oh my God.
That scene, especially the part where he's like grabbing at like Pinocchio's shirt, like trying to like plead and beg for him to save him, and his hands just like transform into the hooves. That's just, it's horrifying, but I love it a lot.
I forgot how excellent that whole sequence was crafted, and that just the build to this confident, well, I'm not going to use that word. I will, because they use it in the movie. A confident ass.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and just to see him become this scared, ultimately scared little kid, you know, is just fantastic. It's truly horrifying, and I agree with you. It's not the one I chose, but it's definitely one of the best scenes in the film, for sure.
Yeah, and I do have one more runner-up. I'll make this one short. When Geppetto goes out looking for Pinocchio, when Pinocchio's getting driven away by Stromboli, and Geppetto's just roaming around in the streets, it's raining, and then he yells out for Pinocchio. Right as he yells his name, lightning strikes and thunder goes, so, because Pinocchio drives like literally right in front of him. If the thunder wouldn't have been there, you know, maybe Pinocchio would have heard him. Maybe Geppetto would have heard Pinocchio screaming from the carriage. Very sad scene. I wouldn't say I love it, but it's a very sad scene. And ultimately my third favorite scene in the movie.
Great. So my favorite scene in the film is actually just like the whole first sequence of the movie. In establishing atmosphere, once we enter Geppetto's home via Jiminy Cricket, and we just get a sense of who this person is by what he does, what he creates, that whole sequence with the clocks going off. Again, it obviously left an impression on me when I was a kid because it's so well executed. And in this rewatch, it was no exception. Absolutely wonderfully done. And you really get to know this lonely, old, wonderful, happy, though, joyous human being, Geppetto, and the creation of Pinocchio all the way through to when they go to bed. I mean, it went by so fast. I looked on the video player. That whole first scene in that home is a half an hour long. Mm-hmm. You just wouldn't have any animation studio thinking that audiences can have the patience to sit through a scene that essentially is an act of a play in one location. I'm telling you, there's no better scene. Well, I'm sure we'll see. We'll go down the line. There'll be better scenes of character development. Really, this is one of the greatest examples of character development in any animated film. It's simple. It's all about the atmosphere and where this person lives, the situation, who they are, and just how they interact are so richly developed that it's just one of the greatest scenes in the film. A second place, if not tie, though, I agree with you. The Monstro chase is just one of the greatest animated sequences of all time, period. I mean, it is surreal. It's so beautifully drawn. It just, you know, 3D animation, you just can't achieve that level of of artistry and just, I guess, surrealism. It really, you could like take a screenshot of that, print it out, put it on a canvas, and put it at the, you know, at the Met, and people would go, "Wow, that's a wonderful piece of art," because it is. Every frame of this movie truly is, and that scene is just a great example of that. So those, I think, are my two ties for favorite scene. All right. Now, Matt and I are going to move on to favorite song. This one was a little difficult for me because obviously there is there's the song that became obviously the Disney anthem, which is When You Wish Upon a Star. But you know what? I mean, the songs here, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how the songs have just so improved from how they function in the story from Snow White. They do function differently. But I don't know. I kind of love Give a Little Whistle. Okay. There's just something about the culmination of that whole sequence, that whole character building sequence to, you know, we're seeing this through Jiminy Cricket's eyes, and the Blue Fairy comes, you know, we've gotten to know someone very well. We're very far along in the movie at this point, mind you.
Yeah.
Believe it or not, even though it's really the first or second scene. And Jiminy Cricket, all of a sudden, his conscience, and just the sequence, the way the song comes in, and the way it works and functions, it's just marvelous character building. It sets the whole story in motion from then on out, the whole kind of rest of the sort of the rest of the conceit of the rest of the film. And I really love it, but music, it's really kind of hard to choose because all the music works so marvelously in this film. The music flows in and out of the action seamlessly, which actually would have been pretty ahead of its time in terms of the evolution of the musical theater. Of course, those inventions were right around the corner with Rodgers and Hammerstein, but it pushed it. And of course, this is using more of the modern musical theater scene than Snow White did. Snow White obviously reverted to more European operetta, whereas Pinocchio's score feels more American. Mm-hmm. It feels more, it has that American edge to it. The score is akin to Irving Berlin and Rodgers and Hart. It's witty, it's ironic, but it's truthful and it's character building. And I think all the songs work marvelously. It's hard to choose. So I just chose that one because I've had that song stuck in my head ever since rewatching the movie.
All right. Well, again, my runner-up, When You Wish Upon a Star. Great song. But
it's okay. I'm kidding. No, okay.
My number one, I absolutely adore. It's called Little Wooden Head. When Geppetto finishes building Pinocchio, turns on all the music boxes, and then they all play seamlessly together. I absolutely love just that scene.
Oh,
in its entirety,
of course.
But of course, the song, the whimsy of the whole scene and the song, all the clocks and the toys playing together. It brings back a lot of nostalgia for me for some reason. I guess that was probably one of my favorite scenes as a kid. But yeah, I absolutely adore that song. Little Wooden Head. Plays very early on in the movie.
That's so interesting. I didn't know that really had was considered a song.
It's listed like that on Spotify,
or even had a title. That's so well. Yeah, I'm sure that's part of like the score. But I didn't. Yeah, that's interesting. I love that. Because it really is a song. Mm-hmm. You know, the clock's going off like that. And that's probably one of the reasons why it's my favorite, you know, scene in general. Mm-hmm. So that's good to know. That's great.
And now, I'm excited to get to this part. Favorite background animation. Now, I've had this scene stuck in my head for a good while. Since we initially conceived the format of this show, I've been wanting to discuss this specific scene. The scene, about 27 minutes into the movie, I believe it's after everybody goes to sleep, fades to black, fades to the scene when Pinocchio first leaves for school. It pans up from like the bell of the town, and then it pans all the way down through the entire town, showing all the children. That shows the multiplane camera in full force, you guys, and I absolutely love that. If you try to compare that scene to something from its previous film, Snow White, it's almost unparalleled at how I guess how much progress they've made in like advancing the techniques, I guess, that they use to film that and to animate that. It's just and it's also just something about the way, trying to like figure out in my head how they would have painted, like drawn that whole scene out, because I'm trying to like picture in my head like the layout of how that would be. It'd have to be like not just like a flat canvas. It had to have been like curved a little bit at least. I don't know. I love that scene. 27 minutes into the movie, you guys.
Matt, we're in agreement. I mean, it's just one of the great...
All right. This is a first, you guys.
No, we usually are. I agree. I think this is one of the greatest and most important shots in all of animated history. Mm. It's just wonderful. It cost... I don't know the exact amount, but it cost a ton of money. And I remember, I think I read something about how Walt was like, even you know, with the amount it cost, it wasn't worth it for that little bit of film. But I disagree. I think it's just a marvelous shot, and it is some of the greatest background animation. The whole film is filled with some of the greatest background animation.
Sure, yeah.
You know, every shot, you look in the background, and it's just marvelous. One thing that stunned me this time was the background animation for in all of Pleasure Island. I actually couldn't look away from the background animation.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It just kind of set up this domineering atmosphere and really was building up the suspense for what was to come, and really marvelous. And all the night shots, you know, just wonderful. So really, yes, I agree with you though. That shot, I mean, there's really no contest. It's just some of the greatest, it's one of the greatest shots of all time.
Yeah, and even like trying to compare that to like future movies, because I'm just like thinking like Bambi is the only other example I can think of where like that level of perfection, I guess perfection would be the good word to use, where that level of perfection is almost matched. I feel like there has never been any other scene, at least in the context of these like original Disney animated films, where that specific scene has been like one upped. I can't think of, at least off the top of my head. I could be wrong. I could, you know, come back in a future episode and slap myself across the face for saying that, but
we probably will. I included this category because at least in the first 30 years of animation, the background art is like fundamental to the films. So I think this is going to be up there. This shot's definitely up there. But I mean, listen, there's some there. We have to, as you said, we have Tyra Swan coming up for Bambi, but we also have Claude Coates and who I think did background work for this one, and we also have Mary Blair coming around the corner.
Yes.
So there's a lot of great artists coming up who did some excellent color styling, and of course that always contributes to the background art. So don't make the final decision yet.
I made my words, you guys, now that Jeremy's mentioned that.
We got some great artists coming around the corner when it comes to background art. But this is certainly one of just the greatest shots of all time in animated history. Mm. That is for sure. Okay, now we're going to move on to one of my other favorite categories, favorite character animation. Now, you might be, I'm not sure if this particularly counts, but you know what? I think it does. The best character animation in this film is Monstro.
Okay.
I mean, it's just,
That's fair.
It counts.
That counts, yeah. That's
fair. I think it's absolutely fair. That is just some of the greatest, I mean, animation of that monster, that beast, that whale. It almost feels so simple. They could have made it grotesque and No, it's all in the shapes and the shadows. Mm. It's brilliant animation in a brilliant sequence, and I gotta give one of the nine old men, Wolfgang Reitherman, credit for drawing one of the greatest character designs of all time, which is Monstro the Whale. That's where I stand on that. Now, Matt, what is yours?
Well, I couldn't think of, like, in the context of this series that we've done, last episode we had a unanimous between Jeremy and I between the scene, I think it was the scene where the queen turns herself into the old hag, that whole little sequence where she's, like, transforming.
Well, her Hulk, yeah, the queen
is a whole,
the best character animation. Yeah, the queen as a whole, that was our favorite character animation.
Yeah.
Which is, yeah, I mean, absolutely. And I think our runner-up for those were also just like all the dwarves.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I was watching the movie, I was trying to like pinpoint something that could like come to the level of that, and I just couldn't. But so for my favorite character animation, there's this one scene, and this is, I guess this counts. This is one scene where I think his name is the coachman, the guy in the big, the kind of big guy with like,
oh,
the red coat.
I know what you're talking about.
He's talking to Honest John and the, what's that? What's his little buddy's name?
Percy? Gideon, right? Gideon.
Gets it, Gideon, not Percy. He's talking to Honest John. Honest John's not his real name either. I can't think of it off the top of my head. Talking to them, and it's called the Red Lobster Inn, you guys. I looked that up. And he's like discussing, he's telling them how the two can make more money compared to what Stromboli paid them for giving him Pinocchio. And there's this like one just like very brief moment where they're discussing like the plan of taking the kids to Pleasure Island, and I think the coachman guy says something along the lines of this, I can't remember off the top of my head, but he has this like disgusting scowl on his face. His like smile looks like almost like, I can't, like Jeff the Killer almost, if that makes sense, if you guys remember Jeff the Killer. It's just like a huge, it was scary. I was pointing out to my friend when we watched it, that specific scene scared me so much as a kid. So that's my pick for favorite character animation, but I do agree with Jeremy. Monstro is a, you know, way above mine.
No, I mean, that's definitely, I actually thought about when I was thinking, who would I choose for best character animation? You know, the coachman actually came up because just the level of detail that goes into his sinister nature is just great. Yeah, I mean, that's a great choice. I mean, really, the character animation all around is such a great step up from Snow White, even. I mean, just we're starting to really see the fundamental principles of animation really come to fruition here in terms of just how you animate human beings, how you create that illusion of life. As the phrase coined by Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnson, who both animated the character Pinocchio. Mm. And you kind of see that really show in Pinocchio. And one thing that astounds me when watching these early films, you just don't see it today. And I'm sure I actually mentioned this on the Snow White episode, is that you see the characters thinking through the thoughts. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is really what creates is one of the most important aspects of creating that illusion of life. You're not just seeing archetypal emotions on their faces. You're seeing them think through the thoughts.
Yeah.
And you really start to see them implement that in this film in particular. You started to see it a little bit with Art Babbitt's Queen animation in Snow White. I think that's why we both were drawn to that character last time, but you really see that start to develop here, and it's just gonna get better and better as we go through these movies.
All right.
Of course, we're gonna take a break from humans for a little while after this movie, but they'll come back. They'll come back eventually.
And that moves us on to favorite voiceover work. Now, you guys gotta hand it down. Cleo is my winner. Favorite voiceover work. Just kidding. I feel like Jeremy and I might have another unanimous agreement on this one. My pick for favorite voiceover work is Pinocchio himself. He didn't say anything, so I'm assuming we have something
different. I didn't say anything because, you know, we have... It's a great choice. That's all I'm going to say.
Well, for me, at least, Pinocchio, whoever... I should have looked it up beforehand, who voiced Pinocchio. Big dummy. Pinocchio, for me, displays the childlike wonder perfectly in his voice. Very innocent, the way he talks. And I feel like even if you, as he progresses the movie, the way he speaks almost changes a little bit when he matures a little bit more, when he finally learns right from wrong. I don't know, it could just be me overthinking it. But for me, my favorite voiceover work is Pinocchio.
That's a great choice. I mean, it's actually very difficult to choose the best voice acting in this film because all the voice acting is so brilliant. Mm-hmm. And even a step above, even just a step above that, the brilliant voice acting in Snow White, just 3 years prior. I mean, Geppetto's voice acting is brilliant. Pinocchio's voice acting is brilliant. Stromboli's voice acting is brilliant. The coachman's voice acting is brilliant. Lampwick's voice acting is brilliant.
He was another one of my picks.
But yeah, just absolutely great. I have to go with Jiminy Cricket.
Oh, okay.
it's just a classic voice. And just, again, in the voice acting, and of course, Ward Kimball's brilliant character animation, Cliff Edwards' voice acting for Jiminy Cricket is classic. It also just, you get that modern sensibility. You feel like he's speaking right to you and letting you in on his thought process, letting you in on everything that's going on. You know, it's wonderful and modern, and it's just great. Okay, so now probably the hardest category of them all, because obviously we love this movie so much. Least favorites, or at least the weaker aspects of the film that we feel need a little bit of improvement. This is difficult. I don't even think I prepared anything for this because I thought I would discover it as we were talking. One thing that is so interesting about this film is the experimental nature of it. And I think even more so then, well, no. There is a bit of an improvement from Snow White in that Snow White often each sequence felt like its own silly symphony. I think we definitely see a departure from relying on the cartoon form, and we see a little bit of refinement going on in terms of establishing feature-length animation as its own form in this movie. But I was struck by almost how little plot there is in this movie, and that's not, I don't think, a bad thing. This is funny, we're talking about least favorites. I think it's actually one of the most interesting things about the film is it's really all about the characters and their situations. So I guess if there's anything weak about the film, it's not necessarily a weakness, it's just something interesting and I don't quite know what to make of it, is that It does feel very situational, that they go from situation to situation to situation, and obviously there's a lot of complexity in those situations and how they culminate, but it doesn't, you know, it's not that it's my least favorite part of the film, it's that I think it's the most interesting part of the film, and I wonder if audiences would have been confused by that structure, because at least with Snow White, it would have been, I think, probably more of a familiar story and a very clear journey that happened. Whereas the journey in Pinocchio is very almost, it's very modernist, actually, of the time that it would have come out, more existential. In a way. So it's not that it's my least favorite, because obviously everything about this movie is great. I just find it the most interesting, and I wonder if audiences at the time would have considered it to be their least favorite part of the film.
Okay.
It's actually, I think, a strength of the film in today's eyes. But so that's the way, that's my workaround for this category. How about you?
Yeah, I was thinking, I can't remember what I said the last episode, what my least favorite, I think I said my least favorite part was the prince. I think we agreed that was like our least favorite part of Snow White.
Oh, right. Yeah.
But for this, it's really hard to pinpoint, like Jeremy said, one specific aspect of the movie. And I guess for me, it's really just like a nitpick, I guess. The pacing in the second half of the movie is a bit slow compared to the first half. Jeremy mentioned in the beginning, the first like 30 minutes almost fly by when you're introducing Jiminy Cricket, introducing Geppetto, introducing all the characters. And then he goes off, Pinocchio tries to go off to school. And then, you know, after, I feel like once Pinocchio goes underwater to find Monstro, to find his dad, that's when it sort of slows down a bit for me. I wish the pacing would have been a little bit faster. But again, that's just like a nitpick in my personal opinion. And it's really, it's really hard for me to pinpoint one specific thing that I not necessarily hate, but like just dislike about the movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, it's interesting. Maybe it is a pacing thing that I'm thinking of, because we go from situation to situation without really even knowing why. Mm. It does, I think there causes a little bit of confusion. And then we're like stuck underwater and we don't really, yeah. We're like, wait, you know, but I hate saying that because obviously it's a fantastic sequence.
Again, yeah, just like
but,
nitpicks
for me. It is, yeah, it's just a tiny nitpick, and I think it's interesting. It's an interesting structure, and, you know, it just shows that Walt was a very experimental artist, and he had artists that he was surrounded by that I think were also very experimental artists, and they just were, you know, just let loose and able to just create this new form of art, and it shows in this movie.
Moving on, historical context. I would like to talk a little bit to you guys about everybody's favorite Disney animated film tool, the multiplane camera. And now, it's very interesting for me watching this film, like we just discussed earlier, our favorite scene. The scene where the camera pans up from the top of the, I think it's like a church bell, pans down, gives a nice, beautiful overlay. All the children running about, coming to school or leaving for school. It's very interesting to look at that and compare it to the old mill, which I can't remember the exact year when that one came out. I'm assuming maybe like 4 or 6 years before Pinocchio released, which if you guys don't know, the old mill was the first test silly symphony for the multiplane camera. I believe. I'm pretty sure I'm right, but first test silly symphony for the multiplane camera. And again, it's used in that film, you know, very beautifully, but comparing that to how much they've improved here to this, that specific scene we were talking about, it's astonishing to me to see how much just these groups of, amazing groups of artists can improve in such a, feels like a, such a short period of time.
Mm-hmm. I absolutely agree. I mean, the use of the multiplane, with that shot, we really start to see it being integrated more into story. If you, you know, you pay close, if you really, like, just watch casually, you start to maybe even not even notice that the multiplane is there, which, of course, is an example that what you're doing is working. It's really the beginning of the mastery of how to really use the multiplane, not just with these kind of zoomed in layers. Mm-hmm. And we'll see as the multiplane starts to be used in a couple of films later, you really won't even notice it at all because of how much they've mastered that effect and how it's best used. But that shot is really, it's the ultimate showing off of the multiplane, which is why it costs so much money. So for the historical context, that really is an important one. I also just think in terms of story development and the character, everything we've talked about today, the story development, the character development, the character animation are just such leaps and bounds ahead in just 3 years that really all the little details in this film amount to being a fundamental moment in the historical context. It's the artist, you know, moving forward with the form with Snow White, and it's also them breaking some of the rules from Snow White too. So they're defining the form as they're defying the form, which is just what great artists do. And boy, is that a team of great artists.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I guess there is one other small note I'd like to make, and I'm sure we're going to touch on this a lot more when we get to the Peter Pan episode. I read the word historical context, and when I read that, the first thing that came to my mind was the brief little scene where the kids are all finally get to Pleasure Island, and they're like panning through all the different, like, I guess, like play areas for the kids, and there's this one, they just had to do it, the tobacco area, and of course, the big ol' tribal Indians are the ones handing out the tobacco cigars. I feel like that is also maybe worth noting for a historical context.
Yeah.
And I mean, like I said, we'll touch on that a lot more when we get to the Peter Pan episode. very excited to.
Well, there'll be that. There'll be a lot of conversations about race and representation and media as we move forward when those things start to come up a little bit more, mm-hmm. and that'll be a really fascinating conversation.
Oh, yeah.
That we hope you think will be fascinating too, audience. Okay, now it's time for the final summation. This is where we briefly just recap our thoughts, and then, of course, we will rank the film on where it will stand in the Matterhorn Movies list of great Disney films.
Big mouthful.
For me, Pinocchio... Yeah, well, yes. for me, Pinocchio is just a marvel, and I think that's the right word for it. It's an exciting advancement. You just feel from these artists and animators that they made Snow White, which must have just been a surprising feat, and then they're just free to run with Pinocchio, and here they're going to run further after this film. But you can see the excitement and the energy that must have been going through the halls of the studio at the time, the new studio at the time. Yeah. I mean, they just must have felt like they were on cloud nine while they were making this movie. So it's just a marvelous film. I mean, I would be remiss not to give this 5 puppets out of 5 puppets.
All right, there it is.
It's just a masterpiece.
5 puppets out of 5 puppets is also what I would rank Pinocchio at. I would agree. Artistic masterpiece, at least. If you're comparing it to the previous episode, the previous movie we did, Snow White, I'm sure my opinion will change once we get to more beautiful-er movies like Bambi. And of course, guys, we have Fantasia next. Can you imagine? I guess just
Can
in the context
it?
Of historical context, coming back to that, Fantasia, Pinocchio, released in the same year.
Same year, which means they're making these movies at the same exact time. But more on that next time, because that's going to be a wonderful conversation. And again, it goes back to the excitement in the halls. I mean, they're just running with this new form, and they're making Pinocchio, and they're making this new experiment in feature length animation at the same time. I mean, that's where I'd want to be if I was an artist.
Yeah.
So, Matt, where now we have to decide where this stands on the list of the Matterhorn Movies list of great Disney films.
Well,
let's decide for a second here. Snow White is brilliant, the one that started it all. It's majestic, it's wonderful. But I don't know. This one really blew me away. I'm sure you feel similarly, yes?
Yeah, for me at least, it was kind of a no-brainer. I'm not that I hate Snow White. I love Pinocchio. Comparing it to Snow White, it's a huge step up, like we just said in the very beginning of the episode. Character-wise,
I agree. Just
story-wise,
exactly.
Everything.
Just those little things, story-wise, character design. I think, Matt, this is now going to rest at number one on the Matterhorn Movies list of great Disney films.
Guys, we're not going to rank every single movie as number one over the others. Don't worry.
It might be like that for a little while, but we'll see. It's going to get interesting when we start really, it starts to become difficult and there's more films on the line. So, great. Well, that just about does it. That is the second episode of Journey Thru Animation. Thank you for coming on this journey with us. Matt, do you have any final words,
guys,
for the audience?
Like I said in the beginning, I feel like a lot of people sleep on Pinocchio compared to a lot of the other original animated films. Pinocchio, masterpiece, in my opinion. Watch it. Disney Plus. $5, $6, $7 a month, you guys. You can watch all of these movies.
Do it.
But more specifically.
Watch it and then follow along with us.
Yeah. Watch it. Watch Pinocchio first, then come watch this episode of Journey Thru Animation. Love Pinocchio.
There you go.
Can't wait to move on to Fantasia. Thank you all for coming out to this episode of Journey Thru Animation. And as always, have a great big beautiful tomorrow. Thank you.
makes no difference who you are, anything your heart desires will come.
Spanish Main, and the Pirates of the